The giant radio mast is gone now. It used to stand there atop the huge concrete globe, one of the most familiar trademarks in the movies. This is the junction of Melrose and Gower. Up there, the Hollywood Hills. Down here, the Hollywood Flats. There's been a movie studio on this site since 1921. And up until the late 50s, this was the headquarters of RKO Radio Pictures. These are the sound stages where Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers danced, where Katharine Hepburn and Cary Grant sang to a leopard, where King Kong made off with Fay Wray, and where a hunchback Charles Laughton cried out sanctuary. Where a 25-year-old Orson Welles made cinematic history with a movie called Citizen Kane. This is where Jane Russell had a brassiere custom built for her by Howard Hughes, where the cat people stalked. Where young Robert Mitchum turned up his coat collar and lit up 1,000 cigarettes. Many of the best and quite a few of the worst moments in talking pictures took place on these stages. Our story begins in the late 20s, right at the start of talking pictures. And here's where the evidence is, the archive of RKO Pictures, containing the public and private life of the studio. The men and women who ran and serviced it, and the stars who were its lifeblood. Many of these files have been untouched for decades, but it is here we will begin our excavation into the life story of RKO Pictures. Because what we're doing here is a life story of the company which we've pieced together in 6 episodes with the help of those who worked and pioneered in the back rooms and behind the cameras, and of course those who appeared up there on the screen. Including Katharine Hepburn, Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, Pandro Berman, Robert Wise, Lucille Ball, Fay Wray, Joan Fontaine, Jane Russell, Stuart Granger, Jane Greer, Edward Dmytryk, Robert Mitchum.
Also because some dame had taken 4 shots at him with his own .38. Made one of them good.
I can't give you anything but love, baby. That's the only thing I can give you, baby.
So this Cinderella is looking for a fella who'll tell her what she's sweet as I am. Looking for trouble, won't mind the trouble if trouble looks like a man.
Rosebud.
Legend has it RKO was born in October 1928 during a meeting in a Manhattan oyster bar between 2 of the most powerful tycoons of the 20s. One of them was the radio baron David Sarnoff, president of the giant Radio Corporation of America, RCA.
Senator Marconi, I'm glad to welcome my friend and my teacher to the American shores.
RCA had patented a sound system for the newly emerging talking pictures. Sarnoff wanted a studio to exploit it. This man had one. Joseph P. Kennedy, father of the Kennedy clan, was president of a company that made and distributed silent movies. This is one of their more exotic properties, the earliest version of Kismet from 1920. Kennedy and Sarnoff agreed to a merger, and RKO was born. The R from Radio Corporation, the KO from the Keith Orpheum Theaters, an ailing vaudeville circuit they bought to distribute their pictures. The publicity held out high hopes for this, the first Hollywood studio created specifically to make talkies. But the radio legacy would be unshakable for many years. For one of their first signings, RKO went for the biggest singing star on the radio. Rudy Valley was one of the most charismatic performers of the era, and legend has it, every housewife's choice. But he'd never acted in his life.
Hi-ho, everybody. This is Rudy Valley announcing from the RKO studios in Hollywood, California. I'm out here with my boys, the Connecticut Yankees, making our first talking and singing picture. They kind of do make me feel foolish or something. Now we're going to play the theme song of the picture, A Little Kiss Each Morning, A Little Kiss Each Night. We'll be so happy, we'll always sing, if we'll remember one little thing. A little kiss each morning, a little kiss each night.
I was really the very first, I think, to sing naturally, to sing as you speak. And of course, it wasn't accepted by everybody. Certain clergy thought that the songs I sang were evil because of the content of love and the way I sang them. And they really, really said, Rudy Valley should not be allowed to sing in the air because not of the content of the lyric particularly, but the hypnotic effect, the sexual quality, let us say. I was born on my friend's side with a tremendous amount of, a great amount of sexual emotion. Now, song pluggers in 1940 in New York City call me the guy with the cock in his voice. That was their expression, the guy with the cock in his voice. That was evidently why, over a period of my 84 years of life, I've known over 145 women and girls.
You'll be my one inspiration. You've changed my whole life from the start. I love you, believe me, I love you. This theme is a dream of my heart.
Oh, Mr. Grant, I'm so pleased to meet you. How could we ever make such a silly mistake?
Oh, don't apologize. It might happen to anyone.
Oh, but you see, we are your nearest neighbors. And this is my niece, Jean.
It was a very bad story, a very,
That's
very bad story.
He so wanted to meet you.
Because sound had just come in. Nobody knew what the hell they were doing anyway. And the director of the picture, Marshall Nealon, who was a fairly capable director up to that point, had two girls that he was crazy about who also happened to be crazy about me when they met me. And he didn't like that particularly. Nealon's mother died in the middle of the film. He went off on a drunk and didn't come back till the picture was over. So you can imagine, between everybody not knowing anything, between the sound and the bad story and everything else, it's a picture we never mention in our family. They're still fumigating the theaters where it was shown, and someday it may take an Academy Award for one of the worst films in the world, and yet every now and then I find somebody who says, we liked the way you acted in it, because you were so sincere, so believable.
I've always wanted to know a real musician, an artist with sincerity.
Sincerity?
That's what your music makes me feel about you. You just couldn't be anybody but yourself. Oh, when you sing like that, I wish you'd go on forever.
Rudy Valley didn't go on forever. Not in pictures, anyway. This is his file in the RKO archive, and here's a memo written right after the release of Vagabond Lover. It was not, in our opinion, a good motion picture, nor was it in the opinion of the public. We did not deem Valley a suitable motion picture personality and did not exercise the first option for his services. It would appear that others in the industry shared our opinions, for no other company undertook to make a picture starring Mr. Valley. But maybe we shouldn't lay all the blame on Mr. Valley. The talkies demanded a whole new technology. They almost had to reinvent movie making. One of the pioneers of sound recording at RKO was James G. Stewart.
First thing that happened when sound was introduced was we defeated the motion picture, because as engineers, we had no concept of a dramatic movement, dramatic delivery, or any of those things. Our idea was radio. You stood around a microphone and you said your lines. You could be a good actor, but you couldn't move about. You could read from a script. Suddenly, they're called upon, and in many of the early pictures, if you look, you've got three actors lined up. They're in a line, and they're talking over one another for conversation, which, of course, is ridiculous. But it was imposed upon by the use of sound.
The answer should be here by now.
Why, that must
but
be...
But, Jean...
That must be what?
That must Jean, be... please.
That must be what the butler was trying to find you for.
What was the butler? What was he... Come on, come, speak up. What is it?
Yes, come.
Well, I really have forgotten.
Well, then I'll see the butler. It must be the telegram.
Those first faltering steps in sound pictures inspired this spoof short made by one of RKO's top directors, Mark Sandridge.
Mr. Hamilton, they just discovered that the microphones have been out of order all day.
What?
Mr. Ginsburg, the voices didn't register in the whole day's work.
Oy.
But in spite of the problems and the detractors, sound pictures were here to stay, and RKO began to search for technical talent all over America. In New York, they found a young jazz drummer who knew something about sound recording. He became one of the founding fathers of talking pictures, 8 times Oscar winner Murray Spivak.
I came home to the wife and said, "You want to go to California for a vacation?" Well, she was too ladette to go anywhere. Very seldom saw me. So we got in the car and drove out here. And I got to RKO Studios, and there were no offices for us. So they put me in a barn, a tin barn that had housed Tom Mix's horse. That was my entrance to RKO Studios. And at the end of about 2 months, I got a script. The first important script was, I think, 7 Keys to Baldpate, which is a story about a tremendous snowstorm somewhere, I suppose, in Alaska. And we had to crank wind machines on the stage. Ground this for 32 days on the set. So I took an old bellows and I put some baffles in the hole where the air usually comes out of. That gave me a low-pitched noise. Then I used a cylinder with silk weighted down, which we normally use in the theaters, and that gave me a high-pitched whistle. And between the two of them, we got sort of a windstorm going. As a matter of fact, the head of the studio liked it so much, he gave me a $50 raise.
Well, now, you're absolutely certain that this is the only key to Baldpate?
Yes, I'm sure.
I can swear to it.
Good.
What are you going to do, lock yourself in?
Exactly.
7 Keys to Baldpate, like many of the early talkies, was originally a stage play, and it shows its origins. The craft of film acting, for the talkies anyhow, had to be invented from the ground up.
What is your mission here?
For some, it seems to have been a losing battle.
Well?
Why did you ask me that?
Because I love you.
And I love you.
Perhaps not surprisingly, the original producer of this 1931 romance pulled out on the first day of shooting. A young man who'd been working in the cutting department was told to take over. Years later, he would become the boss of RKO, Pandro Berman.
The picture starred a man named Ivan Lebedev, who was a Russian by birth, who claimed to be a member of the royal family of Russia, and proved it to us, he thought, by showing us that he had blue gums, which he did. And he told us that all the real aristocracy of Russia had blue gums. When we previewed the picture out in Huntington Park, it was one of the worst disasters that anyone could ever imagine. And yet we were very surprised a short time later to receive about 150 preview cards, the kind that the studio put out always, you know, for the audience to write on at previews, all of which raved about Ivan Lebedev and said he was the greatest new star since Rudolph Valentino. It was as much to our surprise because we knew we had a disaster. And it was only a week later that we found out that Lebedev had stolen these 150 cards from the cutting department and had written them all himself.
For the whole of their first year, RKO got by on a wing and a prayer with a batch of similarly forgettable movies. They did reasonably well at the box office, but they were still relying heavily on adaptations from stage plays. They hadn't yet come up with a real quality picture, a film that would earn them prestige as well as money. A new department on the East Coast was set up to look for original film properties. One of the early recruits was Kay Brown.
Well, I didn't know exactly what I was supposed to do, but I went in, and I found myself placed in a very small office in which there were two stools and two typewriters and two gentlemen. And I found out that what we were supposed to do was to read all kinds of stories, including material from the Railroad Man's magazine up to the very important modern novels. And then we reported on this material to advise the California office as to whether or not any of it would serve as the basis of a motion picture.
Kay Brown had read the best-selling novel Cimarron by Edna Ferber, and she persuaded RKO it was worth parting with $50,000 for the rights, an astronomical sum in those days. For Cimarron, RKO engaged Wesley Ruggles as director. His epic Land Rush is still one of the most ambitious and vivid action sequences in movies. It was the first time in the movies the Western took itself seriously, discovered a role for itself in documenting the history of the frontier. It was shot in one day using multiple camera setups, some 100 feet up, some buried in pits in the ground. There are 2,000 people here and 2,500 horses.
The strange thing, I think only one or two people got hurt, and it was after they were trying to pull up their rigs and the horses.
But how much rehearsal could you have? How could Wesley...
None.
How could Wesley Ruggles plan this?
It was all planned on paper. All of the cameras knew exactly what they were supposed to do, and our orders on every camera to the director, Wesley Ruggles, was do what I tell you. When you get what I want, then you can get any damn thing you want, but you get this. And that was our orders, and that's the way it went. So what happened, we had these close to 30 cameras set up in different parts of the field with different towers out of the range of the main cameras. And we had pits dug where the cameras were down there and they could see the horses and wagons coming up, could see us so they wouldn't get hurt.
Finally wound up to a couple of slow horses. Another guy at the very end was a high-wheel bicycle, and he was paddling his way through this whole thing at the very end.
Cimarron succeeded in winning 3 Oscars for RKO, including Best Picture, and established it as a major Hollywood studio. The star of the picture was one of the fortunate few who survived the transition from silent to sound movies. Richard Dix.
It was the height of the star system. For instance, Richard Dix would receive an astronomical number of letters per month, and some of the other stars too. And some of the stars answered their own mail, but then the studio did answer some of it. And as a matter of fact, I was compelled to forge Mr. Dix's signature. Not really compelled, but I was requested. He didn't care to have that burden. He would autograph his the letters that appealed to him, but the rank and file letters, we sent out just a small photograph, which I forged his signature.
By the end of 1931, the balance sheets of RKO were disastrous. After only 2.5 years in production, the studio showed a loss of $5.5 million. In desperation, they brought in a 29-year-old producer from Paramount Studios, David O. Selznick, with a brief to save RKO from extinction. Selznick decided to expand and exploit the star system as a major key to success at the box office. RKO employees turned into talent scouts. On the East Coast, Kay Brown was ordered to check up on new and upcoming New York stage actors. One young actress in particular had attracted considerable attention.
I was offered a contract by David Selznick, and I said I won't go out there for less than $1,500 a week, because I thought I'd heard about a lot of people going out there and just, you know, becoming one of millions. And I wanted to make it as difficult for them as I could. And I insisted on a play clause so that they could do 2 pictures in a certain limited length of time. And then I was free to come back. That was very lucky for me.
Were you surprised that they agreed to what you demanded?
No, I took a flyer. I said, just there it is. If you like it, take it. If you don't, don't. But so they did.
What did you want to happen, though? You were prepared to gamble it, that they would take you or not?
Yeah, I think you always have to be prepared to gamble everything in practically all of life, don't you? I mean, you have to know how much it's worth to you. I arrived, and I had gotten a steel filing in one eye so that both eyes were bright red, and my eyes were in agony, and I went to George Cukor's office when I first got there. And George, who was a sweet character and, of course, became a great, great friend of mine, showed me some sketches in order to make conversation. And my hair was done up. Oh, everyone always said, à la concierge. And I had a very expensive costume on, which was a pancake hat and it sort of looked like an 18th century riding costume. It was very odd, and with the red eyes. I looked at these sketches. I said, Mr. Cukor, I really don't think that a well-bred English girl would wear these. And he said, what do you think of what you have on? And I was rather taken aback. I said, well, I'd paid a lot for it. I thought it's... And he said something rather rude. And he said, now perhaps we understand each other. Then Barrymore came in. And he said, it was a wonderful test. I think you're going to be a big star. Then he looked at my eyes. He said, come with me a minute. And I went out into the hall with him. And he took a bottle out of his pocket. And he said, I have the same trouble. He said, just, and it'll disappear. He He was nice.
For Hepburn's first picture, George Cukor decided to cast her opposite Barrymore himself, John Barrymore, the one-time matinee idol and survivor of 20 years in silent pictures.
The first scene I did with Jack, I was standing next to the camera, and Jack came in and fiddled around on a mantelpiece, and he was out of an asylum and found his pipe. And then he looked and he saw me watching him and he said, "Do you know who I am?" And either, and this is very interesting, I'm not sure whether I said, "I think I'm your daughter," or "I think you're my father."
"I think I'm your daughter."
"Daughter? Daughter? That's good. My wife's not my wife, she's my daughter."
"You're forgetting it's been years and years."
"Of course, it is years. It's a lifetime." "My daughter's lifetime."
And as I was watching him, I thought, well, the old boy's overdoing that a little bit, isn't he? Oh, dear, it's disappointing. Well, that's what happens. And I was standing there overacting, tears running down my face. And he came over to me and he took my face in his hand. And he looked at George and said, "I'd like to do it again." And he did it in the most subtle, sensitive, marvelous way.
"My, what a lovely room this is. I can't say I like these funny things, do you?"
"No, I like the old leather ones better too. Those aren't the only changes. Everything changes."
"I bet your Aunt Hester hasn't, eh?" "And I bet you. I say, is your mother such a darling still?"
"Look here, Father, you know..."
"Father?"
"You know, we've got to get things straight before she comes back."
"Yes, she'll be back soon, eh?"
George Cukor presented me. And it makes an awful lot of difference whether you appear in a picture or whether you are presented in a picture. And he had me come down the stairs, which I could do very fast. And he had me throw myself down on a rug in front of the fire and do things that were rather unconventional. And my voice was loud, you know, and the sound people would tell her to... And George said, "Get it. Don't smother her. Get it."
"Merry Christmas, everyone. I'm not late, am I? Morning, Auntie."
"Morning."
"Thanks, darling, for the scandalously beautiful dress I found in my room. I shall wear it tonight and fascinate Kit."
"Ah, see what Father Christmas sent Sydney."
"I'm very much obliged to you, Sydney, for the card case."
"It's a cigarette case, Auntie dear. You see, I thought that if you sent me another prayer book, we might do a deal." "Ah, I thought so.
Thanks very much. It's sweet of you. Shall we?"
"What?"
"Swap."
"Sydney, darling, that's rather rude."
"Well, I hate being hinted at. It's against my principles to kneel down and say that I'm a miserable sinner. I'm not miserable and I'm not a sinner."
She did become a star, and straight away. Bill of Divorcement was a hit, and Hepburn herself had been expertly showcased by director George Cukor, another of David O. Selznick's proteges. The audiences responded enthusiastically to a new and startling screen personality.
RKO had a bit of a battle with you, did they not, about your...
My costumes. I just wore dungarees because I'd always worn dungarees. Then they got very ragged and they got... That was through the years. They got used to the dungarees, of course. And old rags. The minute I realized I didn't have to sort of, you know, look attractive. Or what they thought was attractive.
You didn't have to look attractive.
Well, you don't have to look attractive. You can wear whatever you damn please, I think. You know, I always wear the same thing. And if you always wear the same thing, that's one doubtful subject overcome. You never wonder.
In spite of Hepburn's early success in Bill of Divorcement at RKO, 1932 was an even worse year for the studio, bringing a loss of more than $10 million. Not for the first time, the fortunes of RKO were tied to one man, Marion C. Cooper. He was certainly a man with a vision. Cooper dreamed of producing a kind of film that had never before been seen or attempted.
Did you ever hear of Kong? Why, yes. Some native superstition, isn't it? A god or a spirit or something. Well, anyway, neither beast nor man. Something monstrous, all-powerful, still living, still holding that island in a grip of deadly fear. Well, every legend has a basis of truth. I tell you, there's something on that island that no white man has ever seen.
And you expect to photograph it?
If it's there, you bet I'll photograph it.
Marion Cooper was an adventurer and explorer. He'd also been a soldier, an aviator, and a newspaper reporter. With his collaborator, Ernest Schoedsack, Cooper had made a specialty of wildlife movies, often with a simple plotline, and usually shot under difficult and dangerous circumstances. Hollywood saw Cooper and Schoedsack as colorful adventurers, and their pictures were popular with the audiences.
The first interest he had, he went to his great uncle's home, and in his library had two books. One was Stanley in Darkest Africa. The other one was Paul de Chaillu's New Discoveries in Central Africa of Men and Animals. Well, in there were these giant pictures of gorillas, and one had a story, about how they stole children and women and dragged them off.
Now, Anna, this one you're looking down. When I start to crank, you look up slowly. You're quite calm. You don't expect to see a thing. Then you just follow my directions. All right? Camera. Look up slowly, Ann. That's it. You don't see anything. Now look higher. Still higher. Now you see it. You're amazed. You can't believe it. Your eyes open wider. It's horrible, Ann, but you can't look away. There's no chance for you, Ann. No escape. You're helpless, Ann. Helpless. There's just one chance. If you can scream, but your throat's paralyzed. Try to scream, Ann. Try. Perhaps if you didn't see it, you could scream. Throw your arms across your eyes and scream, Ann. Scream for your life.
I had been in New York doing a play. When I came back to Hollywood, I had been here only a day or two when I had a telephone call from Marion Cooper, who was now at RKO. When I went, he just said, one of the first things he said was, well, you're going to have the tallest, darkest leading man in Hollywood. And he just took for granted, you know, that I would want to do it. And certainly he was right to take for granted that I'd like to work with him, because I always had a wonderful, good feeling for Marion Cooper. He was just an original, special, extraordinary person.
Oh, yes, he was the most enthusiastic person about everything he was doing. Had no conception of time at all. We would work from early in the morning until maybe 2 o'clock the next morning. That wasn't every day, but it was frequent, Saturday and Sunday. And he had absolutely no conception of whether you were in a position to go ahead with the work or not. It wasn't that he was inconsiderate, it was just that he was completely one-minded about what he was doing. He called me one time at home and started dictating the minute I answered the phone. And I didn't have anything in my hand, and the phone was a wall phone. I said, Mr. Cooper, I can't take this. I'm just standing here. I have nothing with the wall in front of me. He said, write it on the wall.
Cooper had spent barely a month at RKO looking for a way to realize his dream project when he wrote this letter to David O. Selznick.
It's dated December 15th, 1931. I have prepared, and I'm sending with this report, my conception of this giant terror gorilla and the kind of scenes in which he should be used. These scenes can be made just as drawn in the attached pictures by using an animated figure against a projection background, all played against a dunning foreground, with close-up work of full-sized head mask and hands and feet. So far as I know, this method has never been done on the screen and should prove sensational. It is entirely practical. Marion C. Cooper.
Cooper had originally intended to make King Kong in a real jungle with a real gorilla. What changed his mind when he joined RKO was meeting Willis O'Brien. O'Brien was a pioneer of a new kind of animation. He'd been working for years on a mysterious project provisionally titled Creation. These are a few test scenes that survive from his experiments.
No one had ever seen a dinosaur on the screen, only in still paintings in the museum or skeletons. And that, I believe, fascinated Willis O'Brien most, was the idea of trying to put on the screen things that you can't possibly photograph. It wasn't until a number of years later that the idea that it was done in stop-motion photography came to light in the magazines. I have a model here. It's an Allosaurus, and it has a skeleton that goes completely through the body, all made of jointed bits of metal. And as you can see, in any position that you move it, it will hold its pose. Each frame of film, you have to move the model very slightly and take one picture. You move it and take a picture. And when you get hundreds of thousands of these pictures, you finally get the illusion that this creature is moving on its own. And aside from that, you have to move the tail and keep it flowing so that as he takes a step, the tail is in motion as well. As well as the head. The head may have to shift forward and backward like a camel does in its method of locomotion. So there are many different objects. That's why it requires enormous concentration. And you usually have to shut yourself off and away from everybody, because if someone speaks to you, you forget whether you've been moving this hand up and down or whatever other problems you may have.
When Cooper the showman saw the work of Willis O'Brien, he realized he could shoot his own grandiose project right there on the RKO lot. The figure of Kong would be animated using a combination of effects. A giant mechanized head and limbs, as well as 18-inch high miniatures. The job of inventing the fantastical sounds for Kong and his fellow monsters was handed to a bemused Murray Spivak.
The only enlightenment I got was that they were presumably, most of them were reptiles. So, of course, that put me into the sort of a hiss level. And I couldn't quite visualize a huge animal, 10 feet tall, coming out on the screen going, sss. So I had to concoct noises for these animals. To begin with, the gorilla, he growled for fully a half a minute. And there was no growl in the world that I could record that would sustain that long.
Murray Spivak solved his problem by pioneering a now familiar sound technique. He went to the Zelig Zoo, recorded the roars of lions and tigers at feeding time, then slowed his recordings down and played them both forwards and backwards to create the famous voice of King Kong.
His love grunts became another problem, so I didn't want that sort of noise for that, so those I made with my mouth. I took a huge megaphone and I just cupped my mouth and I went.
The hand built, it was a giant hand that would hold Fay Wray eventually. But it wasn't finished yet. It was finished mechanically, so it would open and close and raise and lower. But it didn't have the fur on it yet. And Mr. Cooper called me one day to come down on the set And I went down with a notebook and pen, expecting to be dictated to. Here was this big, tall ladder and this unfinished hand up in the air. And he said, "Zoe, climb up that ladder and sit in King Kong's hand." Well, it never even occurred to him to tell him I wouldn't do it, although I don't like heights. And Mr. Cooper kept yelling at me, "Zoe, look frightened, that's an animal who's holding you up there." They closed the fingers around me and lifted me up to the roof of the stage, and that's very high indeed. I don't know how high, but it seemed like Mount Whitney to me. And I was unharmed, however.
Sections of my own skirt out, and then they were stitched back. But they were, it was just like petals from a flower, you might say, and just two or three of those. But it did give the impression that people have had that he was removing clothes, but it was just little sections of the skirt. But I thought that was interesting because it was, it was certainly not an obvious thing, but it had a certain charm, it seemed to me.
It was very tender, too, wasn't it?
Yes, it was, uh-huh.
What about the more human sounds? For example, Fay Wray's screams.
We just picked up a lot of screams from her one day, and then they were cut to length. The editor cut those in where he felt the scream should be, and then we worked in and out of it.
Kong's famous battle to the death with the Tyrannosaurus was shot very early on in the schedule, partly to test how the back projection was looking. They filmed throughout a day and a night, with Fay Wray stuck for all that time up a studio tree.
Now, that was just a difficult scene. I think they wanted very much to get that material ready to send to New York for viewing by the RKO management to stimulate their interest in this film. I think it was early morning, very early morning, when we finished it. And Marion Cooper came in, and he told the gathering that he'd just worked me for 22 hours, and he was so proud, you know. He was like that. He used to make this gesture whenever he'd see me. Because that was, you know, Kong's sense of power. He expressed that way. He was the most macho thing in the world. But Cooper would do that, too. But he did have a beautiful imagination. And, well, for instance, when he had this idea that when this great creature came to civilization, that and if he were in New York, as he turned out to be, that he would go up a tall building. First of all, when Cooper was walking in New York, he looked at the Chrysler Building, and he could visualize that possibility. How many people would see that? I don't think many. But then, fortunately, the Empire State Building was built just in time.
Did they shoot him and not hit Ann? Don't get on the roof! Come here! Help me shoot!
And Mr. Shostak are in the film, are they not?
Yes, they were in, I think, most every film they made. They did something, not where they would be recognized. In Kong, they were in the airplane that shot him down. One was the pilot, and one was the observer.
Mr.
King Kong, they created a real tragic hero. Out of all those laborious and sometimes primitive techniques. You can see in the ripples on Kong's fur the finger marks of the operators who were turning his limbs 1 degree at a time.
The premiere at Grauman's Chinese, which I went to, of course, and didn't think it was too much. I was not impressed, and that seems like I'm diminishing it. I really don't mean to do that, but we're all critical of ourselves. And also, I thought there was too much screaming, and I should explain that they had to do that because it was the screams and so much of the screaming that animated the little wooden figure that the tiny Kong was holding. Otherwise, you wouldn't have known that was a live something or believed it was a live something. But the next day, the notices were just really wildly enthusiastic.
This is the souvenir edition of the Hollywood Reporter celebrating the success of King Kong. But the finances of the studio had meanwhile toppled into complete disaster, and not even Kong could save it. RKO was put into receivership. David O. Selznick had already left for MGM, and the man RKO turned to was the creator of Kong himself, Marion Cooper. In 1933, he took over as head of production with a simple brief: to save the studio.
Hey, hurry up with those dishes, will you? It's all right for you to say hurry up. All you do is sit around the house all day and read the paper. While I work my fingers to the bone.
Cooper decided the only way he could pull RKO out of the red was to turn out a picture a week.
And another thing. You know, it's very embarrassing for me to always have the neighbors see me in front of this sink washing dishes.
You're right. And I'm going to do something about it. I'll buy a shade for the window.
The ex-vaudeville team of Wheeler and Woolsey became a regular attraction in the movie houses. Hundreds of these simple, low-budget pictures were turned out by novice directors and writers. This whole movie was shot on the RKO lot outside the short subject department. Among these young hopefuls clowning around in the early 30s are some of the studio's future star directors and screenwriters. Writer Bert Granite had been brought to RKO by David O. Selznick.
Best thing you could do was graduate out of short subjects. RKO had a separate building, and it looked like a mortician's building compared to the rest of the lot. The offices were small. Lou Brock, who was head of the company, had this marvelous swordfish he'd caught. His office was so small, he had to cut off part of the bill of the swordfish so it could fit in. The short subject department was kind of Siberia, and still a marvelous training ground because directors like Mark Sandrich, George Stevens, had their start there.
One of Mark Sandrich's earliest efforts was a curious little musical short, an oddity that nevertheless played a very particular role in the history of the movies.
Never can get better seats than these for an opening night at Grauman's Chinese.
I'm sorry, my dear. If you don't mind, please, let's see Bill Harris.
Turn around, Oscar. Go back as you drove. We've decided to go to the coconut grove.
What's that, boss? The coconut grove? Ha-ha. Iliad.
This little movie helped to save RKO, for the sound men who worked on it hit on an idea that opened up the way for the spectacular musicals of the 30s.
We had a bunch of dancing girls that were supposed to be dancing to a number on a boat in the middle of the ocean somewhere. So how now do we get the orchestra on a boat and put on the number in the middle of the ocean on a ship? So Mark Sandrich, who was then the director and the head of the sound department, we got together and they conceived the idea of making a phonograph record of the number, and the speed was adjusted so that the speed would coincide with the speed of the projection machine. And they played the number through a loudspeaker on the boat,
And it was the beginning of the first playback system, and I think that was around 1933.
Well, he's quite the dilettante. He's so charming and gallant. He's the type of man I've always had in mind.
But you'd never get to say, I love, honor, and obey.
Why?
He's not the marrying kind.
Oh!
Could I lead him up the aisle on that long, last weary mile? All my troubles and my cares I'd leave behind. Oh, he'd leave you in the lurch. You'd just be waiting at the church.
Why?
He's not the marrying kind.
Oh!
When it won the Academy Award as the best short subject of the year, it started what was to become the formula for RKO musicals.
The first of the line was Flying Down to Rio. Exotic locations, spectacular flying scenes, and a gift for the man who was pioneering special effects for RKO. Later on, Linwood Dunn would work on movies like Citizen Kane. At this stage, like everybody else, he was learning his craft and constantly experimenting with new ideas.
I was given a free hand, which delighted me, to make effects, optical effects, on every transition, like a sequence ending in a new sequence, and I said, do whatever you want. Well, I went wild on that. I put in optical transitional effects, and I tried to tie them into the action that it was involved in, such as it was a musical number, then I would have musical notes pop in and reveal the new scene by just traveling mats. And then I had, the first time ever done, I had page turns and roll-ups in action, and looking like a series of postcards, people looking at them and thumbing through postcards. I think I could do it because of the way the studio operated. I had a pretty free hand. I didn't have to ask anybody to try these things.
See that they're all fastened on tight. We don't want any slip-ups.
When you wrote Flying Down to Rio, did you have any idea it was going to turn out such an enormous production number?
I never conceived of girls being strapped to the wings of a plane. I think that that's subject for cruelty to dancers, but that did come out very well. There was difficulty doing it. I mean, what with the fans blowing and the girls being uncertain, but it came out well. That's what people look for now. That's what it's known for. That's the picture in which girls stand on the wings of a plane.
This is all the work of RKO's special effects department. Using wind machines, they strung up the girls and the planes in front of huge back projection screens. Even today, it is still a pretty spectacular routine.
My reaction when I saw the diaphanous gowns and the wind blowing and the total effect of using the dancers, I thought, this number has gone from production to seduction.
Got to the end and they had the adagio dancers on the wings of an airplane, and she makes a jump at one guy who's supposed to catch her, and he misses her, and there's a scream, and you see her falling into space, and then you cut down below, this is a little biplane, there's a man standing there and he catches her. I thought, oh Lord. How could anybody put that on the screen?
In the midst of all the razzmatazz, there had to be some kind of a plot. but clearly it was difficult to discover. Even the stars of the picture weren't altogether sure what it was. Jean Raymond had to play the fanciful love scenes concocted by producer Lou Brock, who described one of them in a memo to the studio boss.
We have introduced a scene on a desert island where an aeroplane breaks down, at which Jean Raymond is taking Dolores from Miami to South America, which for novelty, technique, treatment, and sincerity has not been surpassed on the screen. We have a surprise angle in the scene, which I'm not going to divulge at this time, but it is a great love scene without getting sloppy, mushy, or indulging in over-sentimentalities.
Well, that's pretty high-sounding, isn't it? Actually, we were given the scene, and we went out and we shot it. When he talks about high sincerity and I don't know, some of those other words that were in there, he's talking as though it was something exceptional. The only thing exceptional about it to me was it was incongruous. I mean, here is a millionaire band leader who has a little airplane and he's taking this gorgeous creature to someplace. He engineers something wrong with the engine.
Was that a close shave?
Wasn't it fortunate this convenient beach was at your disposal when the motor went wrong?
Come to find out, he has a little miniature piano right in back of him. And so he can turn around and play music on it and compose a love song. This is kind of unusual. I don't know how sincere it is, but I thought it was a kind of on the ridiculous side. Well, when we finished the picture, we were all so glad because we thought this is going to be the bomb of all bombs. And we have to get out and make some other pictures so the producers will see us in those pictures rather than this bomb. And so we all went out and made other pictures. I think I made four more that year, something like that. And then about a year later, I was in New York. And I was in a cab going downtown. And I passed in front of Radio City Music Hall. And I looked up on the marquee and it said, flying down to Rio with Dolores del Rio and Jean Raymond. And I thought, oh, not Radio City Music Hall. And I looked down and there was a line formed at the box office. It went all the way around the block, clear up to Fifth Avenue, around Fifth Avenue. It was Easter week.
The real success behind flying down to Rio was a young couple who had fourth and fifth billing and who, five reels into the picture, got up to dance in a nightclub.
I'd like to try this thing just once. Come on, honey.
We'll show them a thing or three.
This was the first time a cinema audience saw Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers dance together. They only had this one routine in the whole picture. Within a couple of years, they were the most famous duo in the movies. Their phenomenal success was to prove the saving of RKO Pictures, from a company permanently on the verge of bankruptcy to one of the biggest money spinners in Hollywood. Next week in our Tales from Hollywood, Astaire and Rogers, the full story.
There's a giant gorilla on the loose in New York. This can only mean one thing. King Kong is coming up next tonight here on BBC4, and there's a special red button feature too.